Okay, so welcome again. Microprocessors E315. We were talking about branching. So this is the last hour of this week. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to go over the concepts once again. What concepts? Basically branching. So you can see my slides, right? Because yes, I am sharing slides. Okay, so we were talking about branching. Guys, branching is simply changing the program counter. And I'm going to ask somebody to mute their mic. Thank you. Okay, branching was simply changing the program counter. And about this issue, actually, I've got an email from one of your friends. I couldn't answer the email, so let's see the email first. It's basically asking this particular thing. He or she is asking, what is this program counter? Is the program counter going over the lines of code one by one as the pulses just affect the program counter? Or do we use this to jump between different programs? Well, actually, both are true. But basically, the answer is the first one. But the second one is also true because we use branching. But let me start with the first one. Remember what program counter was. So to do that, I'm going to be stop, not pause, sharing my screen. I hope you can see it right now. So this is, so program counter is something like this. There's a clock. It is creating a clock, right? And it is connected to the program counter. Program counter is no different than a counter in your digital design, from the counter that you've seen in Barbarossa's digital design course, guys. It is simply as you feed a rising edge or a falling edge or a level change. So as you feed a pulse, it is increasing its values. It's a register. It starts with zero, for example. As the pulses arrive, it becomes one, it becomes two, it becomes three. Okay, it's this simple then. So if it is that simple, how do we use it? Well, to understand how we use it, we should remember what was the program counter. Where was the idea about program counter? It was here. As you can see, we've got this program counter here. Here. So the program counter, what program counter basically does is, I'm trying to find the code. It is here. The clock is connected to the program counter. The program counter is just a register. A register means it is keeping some bits of values. In our case, the program counter for the ARM M4 microprocessor is 32 bits. So it starts with 32 zeros, binary zeros. As the clocks arrive, it becomes 0001, 00010, 00011. It is increasing. And what does it change? It is connected to the so-called instruction memory, where the instructions are written. So what I'm trying to say is you've got a line of code, and it is set in somewhere called the instruction memory. So the program counter is pointing somewhere in the instruction memory. And where your program counter is pointing, that line of code is being executed. What that line of code says, it happens, it is executed. So this is written, load a value to R2, because LDR is load register, it happens. And at the next slide, pulse, we come to the next line. So one by one, always forward, because the program counter is an incremental counter. If you feed the pulses, it changes incrementally. So it's first one, then two, then three. I'm talking about decimals, but you know that's a binary number. So it goes on like this. So regarding the question, yes, the counter changes with the pulses incrementally from the first line to the next line, forward direction. However, the second one is also true about jumping between programs. I mean, your friend uses a vague description of when a program finishes. Actually, a program never finishes. You just jump between lines. What is a program? Where does a program start and another program start, ends? It's a bit, I mean, difficult to define. However, what your friend is trying to say is, well, you're at somewhere in a program and you want to jump to another place in a program. Well, you can do jumps. And you can do this by doing this operation, so-called branching. That was what we've been discussing the previous week. So we do branching. Branching is, I mean, in the usual operation, the program counter is being increased. You execute this one, you execute this one, you execute this one. But if you come across a branch operation, you jump to somewhere in the address memory. And the address memory is staked by labels, right? You remember, I always told you these labels are actually addresses in the instruction memory. That's why if you use a branch operation, the next operand must be a label or a value in the address memory. So if I'm saying this, this should be a label. It is a label in my code. So if I observe this code, when I come to this line, it will jump to this line because the program counter will be overwritten. Whatever the value of the program counter is, whatever the pulse will make it by incrementing it, forget it. I'm overwriting it. I'm deleting the program counter value. I'm writing it with SSR in it. So since the new program counter value is SSR in it, and SSR in it is a label, it is pointing to somewhere in instruction memory. I continue from that position. This is called branching. Branching is externally changing the program counter so the natural flow of the program will change. So you jump either in forward direction or in backward direction. A good example is if I had jumped this B, not SSR in it, but B start, I would have jumped backwards. So the program counter doesn't care if you're jumping forwards or backwards. It doesn't know such a thing. It is just a stupid register. And you provide a value to that register, and it provides you where you should look at in the instruction memory. So you should always think of the mechanisms in a microprocessor as mindless machines, because they are. They've got one job, and the program counter's job is to point to somewhere in the instruction memory to show you which code is being currently executed. Any questions? Because this is something important. I mean, without understanding what we've been discussing so far, it's very difficult to understand what we are going to discuss next. Any questions?
Bunlar değil de benim bir tane sorum var aslında. LDR'da da set store'da da hocam mesela LDR 2 eşittir M ve LDR 0 eşittir C, bunları kaydediyor R 0 ile R 2. Store da aynısını yapıyor.
Store is the opposite direction though. You're storing from the registers to the memory.
Ha, biri memory'den register'a koyuyor, diğeri register'den memory'e koyuyor.
Well, one of them STR is putting from the registers to the memory. The other one LDR, mm-hmm, it can be transferring from the memory to the registers, but also it can be transferring between the registers and it can be transferring a value that you provide.
O zaman store'un yapabileceği her şeyi LDR'la da yapabiliyoruz anladığım kadarıyla.
In the opposite direction. LDR is loading to the registers. Registers are these. Uh-huh. LDR is getting from the registers.
Ha. Yani LDR'la memory'den register atıyoruz. Store'la register'dakini kullanıyoruz.
The opposite.
Tam tersi. Tamam.
In LDR, we put something to the registers. It could be from the memory or from another register. That's the LDR. STR is get from the registers, get from here, put to the memory. Okay?
Teşekkür ederim.
Okay. And never forget that. So what is the difference between the registers and the memory? They are both memory, in my opinion. You can put values in it. Arithmetic logic unit can only do operations on the registers. So imagine you have a value in the memory you want to make operations on. There are two values in the memory. You want to sum them up. You cannot sum them up when they are in the memory. You first get them to the registers, you sum them up in the registers, and if you want to write them to the memory, you get them from the registers and write it to the memory using STR. Okay? That's why we have registers and memory. Any other questions about branching or some other stuff? Your friend asked something not related to branching, but you can. Okay. Good. I think I'm checking on nobody. Okay, guys, then we've discussed something else. We discussed something conditional branching. Actually, conditional branching is the way we create logic in our codes. And actually, some of your friends in the previous lecture, previous hours, realized the meaning of this conditional branching. Because when you create logic, it is similar to creating if, else, clauses, for loops, because they check for conditions. When you for loop checks for a condition, because you say run 10 times in this for loop. How will you understand if you've come 10 times? Well, you should define a condition and just count it each time and check it each time in the loop. That's a condition. So you jump accordingly to the beginning 10 times, and in the end you continue this for loop. Or if else loop is do this or not do this, so jump. These are actually conditional jumps in your codes. Whenever you write a C code or a MATLAB code or a Python code, including for loops, while loops, or if else clauses, actually in the corresponding assembly code, you are creating conditional branches. Conditional branch is something simple. In the previous example, what we've done was we've jumped unconditionally. We didn't ask any questions. B, okay, I'm jumping to the here. So when there's a B here, there is no chance that, sorry, this code is going to be executed because this is unconditional. No condition, I'm asking no questions, just jump. That's an order from the top. You just jump. Conditional jump is do the jump if a certain condition is set. What are those conditions? Actually, those conditions are written in somewhere called the program status register. You'll remember the program status register. We've got some registers. You remember in the register bank, we've got these scratch paper registers. And we've got this program counter and some other registers alike. And we had this, let me find those registers. But yes, here we have these registers and the program status register. Program status register is a specific type of register, guys. It keeps some information. And actually, sorry, the information inside program status register is being changed by the arithmetic logic unit, especially these five. And I'm going to be just focusing on the two for this hour. What happens is you make an operation, you add two registers, and there comes a result. According to that result, these bits may change depending on the instruction, guys. So I'm going to just write something on the board, which I have done in the previous week. I'm going to do it again. For that, I'm going to stop sharing my screen and I'm going to be using the board again.
Hocam, okay. Bir şey söyleyebilir miyim hemen yazmadan önce? PCR'daki 15'deki şeyin değişiminin belli bir, yani mesela toplama işlemi yaptığımızda belli bir miktarda mı değişiyor? Yani onun değişimini kontrol edebiliyor muyuz? Tahmin edebiliyor muyuz yoksa tahmin edilemeyecek?
Yes, they are all defined and how they are, the change that we define on them is definitely set. I mean, that's on the data sheet. And I'm going to be explaining only two bits now. All bits you're going to learn. They have different purposes. I'm not going to tell you all of them. This is something difficult about microprocessors course. This is a huge architecture, but I start telling you little pieces of it because I'm telling you the pieces that you need to know right now. So just bear with me and keep in mind that when arithmetic logic unit does an operation, it can change some special function register bits. Some. How? You don't know yet. I'm going to show you some of them. Like how? The first thing that I want to tell, okay, I hope this is an answer to your question, but you're going to be more satisfied when I just go over this example, okay? Just bear with me. Okay, thank you. So guys, how come you make the arithmetic logic unit work? If you do an arithmetic or logic operation, it is working. So for example, you'll remember an instruction. For example, right? This add R1, R0, and R2. This was a very simple instruction, guys. It simply said that we've got these registers, R0, R1, and R2. Get the value inside R0, get the value inside R2, sum them up, and write it over R1. Simple. So what we do is, actually, we are doing many operations inside. We are reading from this guy. So I'm going to elaborate the architectural operations so that you understand. Then first, read R0 and R1. It is automatically done. Actually, this is not even an operation, but I'm trying to make you just realize what's really happening and how much time do we have? We have time. Okay, the next thing is we make the summation. Before we write the sum over R1, we make the summation. And we obtain something called the result, okay? And according to the result, what we do is we just save the result in R1. And actually, you remember, for an arithmetic or logic operation, if we have an S here, it does something else. What was it? So I'm just going to change PSR flags according to the result. So what were the PSR flags? So what is the third thing? The third thing is, let me share my screen again. So the third thing is, imagine you did a summation and the result of the sum is negative because you were adding minus 7 to plus 4. The result will be minus 3 and negative. Then the result would be minus 3, right? The result being minus 3 actually makes the special function registers and flag 1, automatically 1. So this is like a auxiliary effect of what happened. I mean, you did the summation, you had the result here, and plus you changed this because this information will be used by conditional branching. How? Let me get there. So guys, conditional branching checks these bits, actually these 5 bits. How? Actually, when you do the jump, you use the word letter B. And there is these conditions that we define according to these bits. For example, if Z bit is equal to 1, I will call this condition to be EQ because it is, they are equal. I mean, imagine if you are doing a subtraction, kind of. I mean, it's defined as this way. So it is also meaning that the result of the previous operation was 0. So EQ means the result calculated in the previous operation was 0. Or MI means the result calculated in the previous operation was negative. That's why N flag is 1. So these flags change accordingly. We're going to discuss only N and Z now. I'm going to be going into detail for the other ones in the next week. Don't worry, but I don't want to confuse you much. That's why I'm keeping the simple examples for this week. I'm limiting myself for these simple examples. Okay, so what are these abbreviations are for? These abbreviations are for creating new branch operations. I'm going to remind you what was compare, just don't forget it. So guys, you have B branch, B of branch, and you add these conditions and you create them. We've gone over this example in the previous week. If you want to remember it, just go to my YouTube video, or we could go over the same example, but this time B being EQ, okay? So I've got the same example here, right? No, in the previous slides, sorry. So instead of B, I have BEQ, which means I will do this jump if only at this point the result of the previous operation was 0. Well, what is the result of the previous operation? The result of the previous operation depends on the type of the previous operation. Well, I've defined what the result is for an add operation, right? But for a store operation, it is actually simply the result that you transfer. So what this store operation does is, using index addressing, it checks a memory location, goes to a memory location pointed by R2. It gets a value from there and writes it to R0. If the value that you read from that memory location are right over R0, in other words, if R0 became 0 in the end of this operation, then your result is for this operation was 0. That's why after this line, you had an automatic Z flag 1 in the PSR. You don't need an S here because STR is not an ALU type operation. Adding an S here only is applied to arithmetic logic operations, add, AND, sub, mult kind of. STR or LDR will always change these flags. And if this was 0, then I would jump. If this isn't 0, I would do this, then I would come to here. So executing this line or not is only decided by the value that I transfer here. Why? Why did I do this? Well, because this line of code required that. I mean, you will be the guy who is designing the code. You will use this according to your needs. So, for example, you will be waiting for somebody to press the key, which is the previous example. And pressing the key will change somewhere in the memory because that memory will be connected to that switch. If that person presses the switch, that memory will be 1. It's going to be not 0. And in that case, you'll, if you check it continuously like this, you'll realize that it's zero. Okay, it's pressed, go on, kind of. So it will be a wait for press loop. This is how we use conditional branching in our systems. And these are the condition codes, which are related to these flags. You don't have to memorize them, but in time you'll get to memorize them, don't worry. So if you see BEQ, it is checking the actual value of the Z flag at that moment. Okay, any questions? I'm checking the chat. Oh, good. Okay, we're fine.
Aslında benim var.
Please.
R0'ın ya da R2'nin hiç sıfır olduğuna dair bir sıfır olmadığı için BRQ'nun altındaki şeyi atlıyoruz değil mi? Çalışmıyor orası.
Well, yes. And we have some... Actually, this comment is wrong, guys. Please.
Aynen, sıfır olması lazım.
Yes, this comment is wrong. Please. Yeah, I think I've said it in the previous week. Because if this is BEQ, I do the jump. If this is BEQ, then it means Z flag is equal to 1 because it says EQ Z flag is equal to 1. So if I jump, I'm not executing it. So it should have been not executed if Z is equal to 1. This is wrong. The comment is wrong. Thank you for reminding that. Okay. Other questions? Good. So we have gone over our first complicated example in the previous week. We have gone over the self-sum example, and I'm going to be going over the factorial example this time. Actually, this is a function. It's no different than a function that you write in MATLAB or C or Python. It's a function. Whenever you want to calculate the factorial of a number, you don't have to write the same code once and once all over again. You have a function, you will call this function. How are you going to call this function? Well, I'll get there. Because calling a function is a bit complicated thing. You have a main code, you are calling a function, you are going there, and you should get back to the position in your main code. You don't know how to get back now. You know how to jump to that function, but you don't know how to get back. I'll teach you that. Don't worry, in the following weeks. But let's see that it's a function, and let's try to understand how it functions. Because understanding how this guy functions is actually understanding our first for loop. Why a for loop? Actually, we are calculating the factorial. What is a factorial? Factorial of integer is multiplying all integers from 1 to that integer. For example, factorial 5 is 1 times, 2 times, 3 times, 4 times, and 5, which is, I guess, 120, right? So this code is simply evaluating this function. How does it do it? I'm going to be defining how it does it. How? Actually, when you define a function in a language, it could be MATLAB, Python, C, whatever. You define input arguments and output arguments. I mean, the input arguments might be empty or the output arguments might be empty. Sometimes we have no input but an output, but we have input but no output, but we have multiple inputs and multiple outputs. All combinations of different input-output argument relations in a function can occur. Well, never forget this. In this particular example that we want to demonstrate, it is factorial. It is one input, one output. Give me n, I'll tell you n factorial, okay? So I should be providing an input, and I define how I provide it. I'm saying that it will be in R0. So before I call this function, before I get here, I don't know how will I get here, I'll learn that. I'm assuming that there was a number at R0. Whatever that number is, I don't care. It could be 1, it could be 5, it could be 10, whatever. When I finished with this code, I will have the factorial of that number in R1. Now I've defined the function. This is how I defined it. It is like defining some requirements for a software project. It's no different than that, actually. I'm defining it. Write a function in the input. The input, you will read the input from R0. You'll write the output to R1, and the input will be n, and the output will be n factorial. I'm defining, I've just defined it. Now, just obeying this definition, following this definition, I'm writing the assembly code. Oh, it's very simple, guys. What I do is, first, what I do is, actually, I get R0 to R1. This is direct addressing, guys. I'm not using the memory. I'm transferring registers in between. How do I know this? No square brackets. If there was a square bracket, it wouldn't have been a transfer between registers. It would have been something related to the memory, but it's not. So imagine I have some number in R0. Let's say it is 6, 10. I'm keeping that number in R1 as well. And never forget that when you use LDR or STR, you don't lose the source. So I have these this number at N, 6, 10, whatever, both in R1 and R0 at this point. Okay? We have time. Okay, now I put a label here because I'm going to be returning back here. This is going to be my loop. So actually, I'm starting a for loop here. If you're writing, if you had been writing this program in MATLAB or C or Python, you would start your for loop at this point. So what I do is I subtract 1 from R0. So if I have 10 in R0 would have become 9 at this point. Okay. I check if R0 is 0 or not, because when I subtracted 1, I've created a result. And since I have S here, that result affected the flags 0 and negative the flag, whatever. I'm checking if the flag is 0 or not. My value was 10. The flag cannot be, the Z flag cannot be high because it is EQ. It is checking the Z flag if it is 1 or not. The Z flag being 1 means the Z flag being 1 means this previous operation had a result which was 0. It is not. The result was 9 because N was 10. Freeze this moment. I'm changing the example. Imagine R0 was 1. In this case, R0 1, R1 1. I make a subtraction. R0 minus 1 being 0. R0 is 0 now. What is the result of this operation? 0. The result is 0. And I have an S here. Z flag became 1. Okay? As you can see, I have BEQ jump to fin. I would jump it. At this point, I did no operations. What do I have in R1? 1. What did I have originally in R0? 1. What is 1 factorial? 1. So it's working. 1 factorial is 1. So this handles the situation for 1 factorial by doing no multiplication operations. Did everybody get the example when R0 was 1? I'm going to get back to the case where R0 was 10. Okay, questions? Mic's opening.
Hocam, geçen example'da BQ olduğunda 1'e eşit mi diye bakmıştık, şimdi 0'ya eşit mi diye baktık.
The result being equal to 0, Z flag being equal to 1. So when the result is 0, the Z flag becomes 1. So you should be careful about that.
Bir daha söyler misiniz?
Well, you are checking the result. Result being equal to 0 means there's a flag here, this flag. It is equal to 1. So actually this condition checks the flag being equal to 1. Flag being equal to 1 means the result was being equal to 0. Be careful about that.
Anladım.
Okay? Yeah, good question, by the way. Very detailed. So everybody gets, so many people could be doing the same mistake. So I hope you got it right now. Okay, now, so we are going over this example, factorial. So I get back to the example where R was 10. So R 10, R1 10 again. I start the loop. I subtract 1 from R0, it becomes 9. The result is 9, so it is not equal to Z flag is not 1. So I don't jump, I continue. I multiply R0 with 1, R1. R1 was 10, R0 was 9. 10 times 9. So in R1, I have 10 times 1. I continue because this is unconditional jump. I don't ask questions, I jump here. Subtract R0. Subtract 1 from R0. It was 9. It became 8. The result is 8. Do I jump? No. I continue. Now I multiply R1 with R0. R0 is 8. R1 was 10 times 9. Now R1 becomes 10 times 9 times 8. I continue until this guy becomes 0. And at that point, R1 will be 10 times 9 times 8 times blah, blah, blah, blah, 2 times 1. Which is a factorial 10, and you've got the answer. That's how you construct an actual factorial for loop, guys. So that's the example. So at this point, you got a new instruction, which is MULF, multiplication. It stands for multiplication. It's no different than add or sub. But remember that if you want this instruction to change a flag, you should put an S here. Since I'm doing no checks after it, I don't need to put the S. But for this one, I'm doing a check according to this result. That's why I'm deliberately putting that S here. Any questions?
Hocam bir şey sorabilir miyim?
Please.
Subkomut hani faktöriyel işlemi yapıyoruz dedik ya. Peki negatif sayılar, negatif sayı olsa mesela R0'daki.
Yes.
O zaman nasıl bir sonuç elde edeceğiz? Sonuç
Let's
olarak yapılmaması gerekiyor ya.
Good question. Well, because the definition of the factorial is you don't have to, you shouldn't provide negative numbers. Well, in that case, if you write a good program, proper function, it should handle it. For example, if you had a piece of code here, which checked if the number in R0 was negative or not. For example, this line of code could check it. Stop share.
You remembered the instruction which was CMP. CMP R0 with zero. What did CMP, sorry, this is CMR, this CMP did? It simply did this operation, R0 minus zero, this value. If R0 minus, it creates a result out of it. But it doesn't write the result to anywhere because it is not like sub. It calculates this result, but doesn't write it over R0. It doesn't change R0. It's trying to understand the result of this operation and changes the flags accordingly. You don't have to put an S here. That's the beauty of CMP. You just do the compare to change the flags. You don't need an S here. So it calculates the result and changes the flags. If this number is negative, this result would have been negative, right? So if the result is negative, I would have put BMI in. Or the more beautiful code would have been. Something like this. LDR R1 minus 1. BMI fin. I'm connecting myself to the previous program. So what happens is, I check if R0 is negative. If it is, then I put a minus 1 value to R1. Okay?
Okay.
Sorry, this is not the right way of doing it. Sorry. I'm changing this line of code because it changes the... Okay? So I initialize R1 with minus 1. You'll understand why did I do this. Forget it. Then I compare R0 with 0. If R0 is negative, it's going to set the end flag to 1. If it is negative, I jump directly to the end of the code. What did we have at the end of the code? Nothing, you are finished. What do you have in R1? Minus 1, because you had this minus 1 here. So this is a way of handling it. So I've defined a new function now. This is a factorial. You feed positive numbers to it, and I will give you the positive factorial and factorial. But if you give me a negative number, since it's not defined, I will always provide minus 1 to you at the output. That's how we define it. Okay, so it depends on how you define it. I handled this negativity situation. Cevap oldu mu bilmiyorum.
Şey hocam, birazcık oldu da şey anlamında. Peki hani diyelim ki yanlışlık yaptık, eksi bir sayı gitti. Sub komutuna. İşte eksi bir komut geldiği zaman hani kod yine devam mı edecek o kodu atlayıp?
Yani what will happen? So okay, we don't make this correction. What will happen in this negative case? Well, we can go over this. Let's go over it. So imagine we have R0 minus 3, for example.
Okay.
I have R1 minus 3. I subtract minus 3 minus 1. Now R0 becomes minus 4, right? And is it 0? No. It will never be 0. You'll be stuck infinitely in this for loop. So you should change this because it will just freeze your computer. It will stop your computer working. So this is a situation you must handle. Okay?
Okay.
Okay, guys, I think that's enough for conditional branching. And before we finish, we've got only a couple of minutes. I'm going to tell you something about the directives. Guys, in every computer language, actually not in MATLAB, you don't have it in MATLAB because MATLAB is very simple. In Python, in C, you have the main code and you have your codes. And before you start, there are a bunch of things written up before the main code. Include something, import in Python. You remember those, right? It is telling, actually, these are called the directives. The codes you write are of two categories. The directives and the codes. The directives are actually telling the compiler something. You are telling that, hey, compiler, I'm going to write a code, run it. But before you run it, keep these in mind. So whatever you write up is actually compile time code. Compile time code is means it doesn't run just like the program counter, you know, because if for a code, what we understand for a code is program counter points that code, right? It is not that kind of code. It is like a preparation for the compiler. Okay. And we have our directives as well. And those directives have some meanings. You don't have to learn them. And in the labs, we'll provide them. In time, you'll get to know them, but I'm not going to ask any questions about them because they are not related to the microprocessor architecture. But in time, as you use them, you'll get used to use to them, but you don't have to. I mean, you're not responsible for it. So when you see, because next week the labs will start, when you see a code, don't be afraid by these directives, guys. These directives will mean something, but you are not related to it. You will start your code after your main code. It will write start or main, and that will be your code. You will change that part of the code. And actually, in the first lab, your teaching assistant, Erhan, will explain all of these. So before we start, I just wanted to tell you this. The region that you'll be responsible will be those assembly codes, not those directives. So you want to understand directives, I understand. In time, you will. Okay? That's an explanation I want to make.
Hocam ben
okay.
Bir bitirdiğini sanmıştım. Ben bitirdikten sonra da söylerim hocam.
Okay, I'm finished. You can.
Ha. Şey hocam, office hour'ınızda Zoom mu açıyorsunuz acaba? Benim
office hour dersten hemen sonra the office hour is just in Fridays and actually it's connected to the course. We just stop recording and you ask my questions to me. You couldn't attend them, I guess. Friday.
Ha, aynen. Evet, evet. Friday'de attend edemedim de bu sefer attend etmem lazım.
Okay, okay. If you want, just... Yeah, so it's like, okay. Any, any questions?
Benim staj şeyimsizsiniz de, benim staj deneyim
okay. Sizinle... We will. I didn't finish it. I have some things to tell about microprocessors.
Anlaştım,
okay.
Tamamdır.
Okay, your friend is asking, what about zero factorial? Good question, because zero factorial is not handled in this situation as well. Why? This is zero. This will become zero. I subtract minus one. And I will enter an infinite loop. So you should add a code, just like for negativity, a code for zero factorial. Because zero factorial is one. Your friend just realized something important. This code does not handle zero factorial. So you should put. So for example, I asked a question in an exam in the midterm. Write a function which evaluates factorial operation in assembly. And handle zero factorial and negative values as well. If you've written only this code, that would be a partial answer. Okay, I'm not saying that it will be a wrong
answer. Bir tane B'ye I koyup böyle daha küçükse eğer direkt belli bir sonucu atatabiliriz.
Do a check, yes. Do it, definitely do a check to accomplish it. Just find something and just solve it, okay? Berkay, şeyde e-mail at ben sana cevap veririm stajla ilgili acil bir şeyse, tamam?
Okay. Yok, acil değil. Acil okay. Değil. Sadece bilgi almak ve okay. Yani hiçbir bilgim yok. Onun nasıl yapılacağına dair de bir fikrim yok. O yüzden...
Okay, guys, so we don't mind much about these directives. In time, I'm going to tell you what these directives are. Just understand the assembly code. And the labs are starting. Ask your questions to Erhan. There are some explanations here, but Erhan might change them. He is fully responsible. So these are old. I don't think that these are still, these mean something. So please follow Erhan's instructions, okay? And you prepare for the labs. You definitely have to. Okay. Any questions? We're about to finish.
Lab hakkında ben soracaktım hocam ya. Hani bir program indirmemizi istemiştiniz ya bize. Demiştiniz hani kit alamıyorsanız program indirin onun üzerinden test yapabilirsiniz diye. Fakat şey, hani Kale'in kendi sitesine girdiğin zaman bir sürü program çıkıyor. Hani sizden rica etsem bir link koyabilme şansınız var mı acaba?
Okay, your friend is asking, he needs more information on Kale. Guys, there is a fantastic lab manual Erhan prepared. Read the manual. Actually, these questions are all answered in the manual. And actually, even you have the kit, you will need Kale. You need Kale to upload to the kit or use the simulator. The questions that you answer are all, the questions that you ask are all answered here. Let me show you. Okay, you are asking me to provide a link. The link is already there. Let me put it. Can you see the website, right?
Yes.
So it's here, guys. This one. Okay, please read the menu. It's all been answered there. When I say you have a very good teaching assistant, I mean it, guys. He prepares manuals for you so that you can just do whatever you want to do on your own. Okay, just you need this. If you haven't gone over this, it's a bit late to do it. So because you've got 1 week left, please prepare. Okay, I think we're done. Time. Okay, we've got some time. Okay. So I get back to the course. So guys, what I was saying, the directives. Huh? Okay. So guys, you're not responsible for the directives, but I'm going to introduce them to you because they are simple. I mean, they are very simple things. Whatever you write, you will realize that it will start with this value, thumb. Thumb is this, but it means you are writing an ARM assembly code. It is, I resemble it to Besmele because it says that, hey, Kale, in this code, I'm going to be writing ARM assembly. Because Kale is capable of writing different types of codes as well. You are telling Kale, hey Kale, in these lines of code, I'll put some directives. The first directive is thumb, because my codes will be assembly. Okay. The second one is area. Actually, guys, when you do some operations, I say you write a code and it's being put in the instruction memory or in the data memory. In these directives, actually, you can manipulate where to put where. I put my codes here. You won't have to. Actually, you will always change a project that we provide. So you don't have to learn these details. But this is what it's done. Area means change a piece of memory means. Since this is code, it means what I'm going to be writing will be written to the instruction memory, it's saying, because you are going to be writing codes. You don't have to understand these. I'm introducing them to you, okay? We are going to provide you codes. They will have these already. You'll be changing the code parts only. So you don't have to understand, but understanding them will give you a broader perspective. So it's area, directive instructs the assembler to assemble a new code area or data area. So you are going to write to the instruction memory or the data memory. The Kale will understand because you can write a block of data to data memory as well using Kale directives. You won't, don't worry. Okay, export start is actually export is creating a global variable so that anybody will understand it. Why? What is anybody? You are writing a single file of code. Other files can see it and will have to see it. You don't know why, because you'll be in this course writing single file codes. But you will need this for some reasons, for some architectural reasons. And when we learn interrupts in week 12, you will have an idea. But until now, you don't have to. Export start means this, and start will be your main. So after start, your first line of code will start, guys. Okay. So your code will look like this. Directives, thumb. You don't have to care about this. And here starts the code. Okay, my code starts from the memory location label start. Start move. Just like the start move that we've written in our codes, just like this one. So let me find this one. So these codes will be written after the directives, okay? So this is how your codes will look like in Kale. How to create codes projects? We will provide a project to you. You'll start by changing the codes parts and learn debugging, okay? Erhan will teach you how to debug. With debugging, you'll be able to see inside registers. For example, when I do some board sessions, I draw registers, right? And I say, I have zero in that register now, I say. You will see actually register zero in Chaos interface and see that it's zero. Or after some operation you do subtraction, the result of the operation in R0 if it is writing to the R0, okay? So guys, actually that's what I'm going to be telling you this week. I think we're done. Now, let me stop